By the 1978 World Cup finals in Argentina, the West German squad were past their best. This was to be Helmut Schön's last tournament, and Joep Dervel would step up into the coaching role with a natural ease. And it was Dervel that took the West German team into the 1980 European Championship 2 years later.
I wasn't able at the time to draw on a wide selection like we had in 1976 or after 1974. There was a generation gap in Germany. A generation which wasn't a great one, I mean as footballers. But then the young players turned up again, whether a Rummenigge, Hansi Müller, or Alofs, or Stilicke, or Schuster, or Kaltz, or Schumacher, or Forster.
Again, 32 countries competed in this, the sixth European Championship. This time there were differences. After the preliminary rounds had been settled, the successful eight nations were to play in Italy from two groups, the winner of each group going through to the final. Bernd Schuster of West Germany was the player most Europeans wanted to see.
I knew him at 17 or 18 years of age. And he played his first international against Argentina in Berlin. He was able to play the ball through any player from one foot to the other without anyone being able to do anything about it. He had an eye the like of which you rarely see, in the same league as Beckenbauer or Netzer. At that level, one could believe that he would increase in stature and become a really great player for German football. We had our disagreements, I must admit. Because he was, in fact, a strong-willed man. And great players are strong-willed players and personalities. It is just the way it is, and one must accept it. You must allow them their peculiarities. And I believe that it was always understood, to some extent, that the players are creative in their way. That they create beautiful football.
Against Holland, yet again, the Germans were victorious. Schuster ran the show from midfield, and Alofs found himself a hat-trick hero for Germany. That same old niggle still existed between these two European neighbors, and a Dutch penalty was hotly disputed by the Germans. Johnny Rep made it 3-1 from the spot, and Germany were feeling nervous. A second Dutch strike came just a little too late for a full revival, and Germany moved closer to another final where they would meet Belgium, the surprise winners of Group 2. At the Olympic Stadium in Rome, Jean-Marie Pfaff, who later played his club football with Bayern Munich, was keeping the Belgian goal intact. But even Pfaff had little to answer to a Schuster run and a decisive strike from Horst Rubisch, the powerful German forward. Hans-Peter Briegel Horst Rubisch and Klaus Allofs, the man who had scored three against Holland, kept up the German pressure until half-time. After the interval, the Belgians fought hard for an equalising goal. And when Van der Elst won a penalty for his team, the Germans were incensed because the foul they admitted to was outside the penalty area. One goal each, the game was poised for a winner. Schuster came close. Pfaff excelled. And Derville had a time check. Then when Rummenigge sent over a corner and Big Rubisch climbed high into the Roman night, Joop Derville knew he had secured his place in the German Hall of Fame.
The most beautiful of cities in the world have always been the ones where we won. You can't give any other answer. But of course it's true that a European championship, such as in Rome, as national trainer, a trainer particularly for Germany must, I think, be a winner. One must become European champions, or one must become world champions. I'm not sure if runners-up count for very much, though we've managed that too, five times.